Please start the recording, sir. A very good afternoon to all of you. And thank you once again for coming over here sharp on time. And today we have a very special meeting for all the colleges who are participating in the regeneration project. And basically today we'll be discussing more on the sample testing procedures, protocols, and other details. And we are extremely happy that with the involvement of the Pollution Control Board, Water Resource, various departments, and experts from the environment departments of various engineering colleges in Kerala, we have come up with today's presentations. And today is going to be almost a final draft. And I request that every participants may kindly observe. And if you feel that any changes is required, or if you have any questions, as usual, please ask through the chat box. And based on the feedback on today, whatever we are getting, we'll be presenting to the government on the Thursday's regular meeting. So that day, it will be the final one. And since then, every colleges in the Kerala state will follow the same procedures for which the draft will us discussing on today. So once again, thank you for all the team members from the Water Resource Department, Pollution Control Board, and various engineering colleges for continuously working from last Thursday until yesterday to arrive at today's the most three exciting presentation which we are looking forward. And also Mr. Pranab Jyotinath, IAS, sir, is holding various positions as secretary as well as the managing director. KADC, sir, you have lots of responsibilities, we know that. So sir will be here with the introductory remarks, and later he may be leaving for other meetings also. So on behalf of the entire audience over here in the function, sir, we welcome you, sir, to this function. And also, sir, we are welcoming all these presenters, Mr. Johar T.S., Dr. M.G. Gracious, Dr. Deepesh Vaishan, from scientists from Central Pollution Control Board, Bangalore, and all the professors, Dr. Suja Madam, Dr. Harilal Sir, Professor Shaini Varghese, and all the faculty members, all the principals, and all the students, NSS volunteers, you are all welcome to this program. And sir, now I request Sri Pranab Jyotinath, IAS, Secretary of Water Resource Department, for his introductory remarks. Thank you, sir. He's always been an inspiration and a constant motivator to us. Sir, over to you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, Sudhanlal ji. And I missed last two meetings that we're having with the Pollution Control Board, and also in regard of the water quality testing parameters. Once again, I welcome all the participating colleges with faculty, students, and department officers. And as you know, in last nine weeks, we have come a long way. And we started from something where we are not exactly aware about how to go ahead. But now today, we know the things that we should do. And we are aware about what kind of, if you all remember, we were aware how to prepare a DPR, we're asking those type of questions. But now today, we've gone into Excel fundamental details, how to collect sample, what are the things, how to, what are the parameters to float. So we have go to that level, and there are experts on the subject who has been with us in training all the, to bring each and every one of you in the same platform. Because we are looking, we are trying for a uniform pattern of document, which in course of time will be utilized for in the process of the reducing the pollution in the rivers. And to a large extent, I'm sure so far my communication with to all of you in current last 8 weeks, we have been able to remove our confusions to a large extent. My my expectations have gone up manifold after meeting all of you. Now there are a large number of other issues also in the department are coming. I think gradually all those aspects also will be asking and requesting your participations. I would not extend further because this is a very technical meeting and I am absolutely a non-technical person, but still my best wishes, and I'm happy that Professor Sojan Lal and Suza Madam, all of them are taking extreme care in making this a success with a lot of hard work being put into it. They are making me, someone like me, encouraged and inspired to look into. Maybe sometimes I am not being able to give much time because of my couple of assignments in the government. I look after PWD, KSTP, and all these things, KITC. So sometimes I run across meetings, but still my heart is there in this topic, something that you have been doing. I would love to join you. Once again, I'll be maybe not going away from the presentation. I'll just, another presentation is on, I'll be into that, but still I'll keep myself connected to this meeting. And whenever I get time, I'll be like trying to, because as a learner, I also want to know a little bit about topic. Once again, I thank all of you and welcome you and hope this, our entire effort will be great, great success. Thank you so much.
Sir, thank you very much, sir. It's all been a pleasure and being with this. And it's really good to see your tremendous support all the time, sir. And also, yesterday, the pre-final year classes have been started. So some of the faculties are already informed that they will be, they are not been able to come today physically, but they'll be listening to our recorded videos later on. But still have a very large numbers are coming up, and slowly I'm sure that they will catch up also. So once again, thank you, sir. And we are going for the next agenda items. Sri Johar TS, for the sampling protocols for water quality monitoring. Over to you, sir, Johar, sir.
Okay, sir. Thank you. Good afternoon, everybody. On behalf of Water Resources Department, I am making this presentation. I hope that I am audible to everybody.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay, sir. Let me share the screen. Is it visible, sir? Is this
presentation? Yes, sir, it is visible. You please go ahead with the display of
this. Go ahead, Johar, it is visible.
Okay, thank you, sir.
And also Preeti from Water Resource IDRB also joined. Thank you, Preeti.
Okay, sir, let's start this presentation. Actually,
yes, please go ahead, sir.
Working with the Water Resources Department, especially in the domain of water quality, for the last 15 years, we have a lab here at Thrissur. This is actually functioning under field study circle, that is under IDRB. And we are now running this lab with the funding of National Hydrology Project. Okay, so what we have acquired all these years, I am sharing my knowledge to all. This is the basic concept of this presentation. Okay, so I am actually concentrating my focus on the sampling protocols for water quality monitoring. Before that, before straight away going into the sampling details, first let us know that what is water quality. Everybody might be knowing that water quality is the chemical, biological, and physical characteristics of water. We know that good quality water is, we have to drink only good quality water, otherwise we'll catch up with some disease or waterborne disease or something like that. So always it is advisable to have a potable water with the quality standards. The physical means, physical parameters like pH, conductivity, temperature, etc. we measure, then chemical constituents. What are the constituents dissolved in the sample? We also check that. Then biological state of water. That means the presence of pathogens or disease-causing microorganisms present in the water. We detect that because these are the, microorganisms that actually cause, cause the diseases two people. Okay. Then how water quality actually changes. Actually, the atmospheric, whatever we are getting as the precipitation, it is supposed that it is in good quality. But in the atmosphere itself, the pollution starts from rainwater. A lot of sulfuric acid, sulfur dioxide or carbon dioxide are present in the atmosphere. When the precipitation starts, these water reacts with the, sulfur dioxide and carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, and later it falls into the earth as acid rains. And likewise, once the precipitation reaches of the earth, it carries the water, it carries the dissolved impurities, and that ultimately reaches the rivers and lakes and also the oceans. Then another thing is that while we are getting the this rain into the earth, a certain amount that percolate into the underground also. That percolating water will react with the underlying rocks, and that also pollute the groundwater. Apart from these are actually the natural or the geogenic nature of pollution. But another factor is the human or man-made activities, like industrial waste, municipal waste. We are dumping a lot of waste in these forms, and that also a root cause for polluting the groundwater as well as the surface water. These are the major types of pollutants, pathogenic or microorganisms like virus, bacteria, etc. Then organic matter, algae. Then urines like nitrogen, phosphorus, etc. Then cations and anions. It's a major group like calcium, magnesium, potassium, sodium, white sulfate, bicarbonate, etc. Then the trace compounds, of course. These are very harmful to human beings, like arsenic, copper, mercury, zinc, cadmium. Nowadays, we are facing this pollution, the mercury pollution, because this is expelled from the, from the tube lights and CFLs, exactly. Exactly from the CFLs, and a lot of guys are using this as landfill, and ultimately this leaches into the groundwater as well as surface water. It's a terror now. Then pesticides like endosulfan, lilan, DDT, etc. These also coming from the agricultural fields. Then the major sources of pollution we can categorize into two. One is point source. Point source means we exactly know where it is coming from. Like industrial waste, hospitals, sewage tanks, marketplaces, etc. Another one is non-point source. We don't know where it is coming from. We cannot pinpoint out the source of pollution. That is runoff from agricultural field, then urban waste, etc. Then actually, the objective of water quality monitoring depends on these five W's. Why? The reason or purpose behind sampling. Why we are monitoring the water quality? So this is actually for the assessment of different uses of water, like for the purpose of drinking or for irrigation or for some other surveillance activities like that. Then where means the site selection. That is also very important. From where we need to collect the sample, that has to be fixed before we are taking samples. Or where actually the problem of this, that of course is very important. Then which the parameters to be analyzed. What are the parameters to be analyzed for monitoring or for assessing the quality of water? That is also very important. Then when frequency of sampling. Whether we are planning for a monthly sampling, or yearly sampling, or bimonthly sampling, or even daily sampling, like that, we can plan into the institutions designated for doing this water quality analysis. What are the institutions capable for assessing the quality or doing this monitoring program? Then water quality monitoring methodology. All these steps involved in this water quality monitoring methodology, like setting water quality monitoring objective. Because I have already told that whether it is purpose or for irrigation purpose or for some other surveillance purpose, like we have to set that goal first. Then assessment of resource availability. Without any resource, we cannot straight away go for this monitoring. Like resources like laboratory facilities, that is very important. If we don't have a laboratory facility, so there is no meaning in taking sample and analyzing for it. Then transport facility, of course, from our laboratory to sampling site, we have a hassle-free return the same in time to our lab. Then, of course, the third is manpower. Without manpower, we cannot carry out all these activities. Like as for sampling, a group of people are required. That is essential. And for analysis also, competent persons in the lab. Then recognizance, and that is another step. Next step, recognizance means we need to have an idea of the area where we are, from where we are collecting samples, what are the land use there, any problem, any industries there, and any source for pollution we are expecting from there. This is also come of this recognizance survey. Next is network design. Network design means we need to finalize the optimal number of samples. If there is a reverse wedge, we are planning to monitor. So from where we collect samples, how many samples we collect from that stretch, that is the optimum number of samples. Then sampling frequency, of course, whether it is for daily monitoring or for some surveillance purpose, we need to sample it hourly also. Like we did some studies in Pamba Basin, for, that is for the Pilgrim Basin, and at that time we did for hourly DO. So a lot of pollutant loads are coming into the Pamba region. Then like that, we have to set the sampling frequency. Then parameters required, yeah. That is also very important. What are the parameters to be analyzed? Whether we need to analyze any physical parameters, or we shall go for then pesticides or some other heavy metal analysis. That all depends on the type of pollution we are expecting or based on our objective of monitoring. Then comes the sampling. That is the focus point of our presentation today. Sampling includes the representative sampling. That is from, if we are collecting sample from a river, that should be a representative sample. It should be in homogeneous nature. Otherwise, there is no need of collecting samples. Then field testing. Some parameters like pH, conductivity, temperature, TDS, these are all time dependent. These are known as, otherwise known as in-situ parameters. That should be tested in the field itself. Then sample preservation and storage. This is also very important. Once we collect the samples, that should be preserved in the proper way. Otherwise, we will not get correct measurements, or while we do the analysis in our lab, that will differ. The results will differ. So this preservation is also very important. Then comes laboratory analysis. In a laboratory, whatever we samples we have collected, we have taken that into our laboratory and analyzed for all these physical, chemical, microbiological, heavy metals, and pesticides. Then, of course, the data management. Whatever data we got or whatever the test results we have finalized with our samples, that should be properly analyzed. That is data analytics, then interpretation of data. Okay, based on this. Records we interpret what will be the cause of pollution there, and is there any mitigation to be, is there any possibility of mitigating these pollutants, etc., etc., and then of course the reporting. Otherwise, once we do all these exercises and we will not publish it, means there is no use. It should be useful to the public also. So reporting is also very, very important. So these all factors contribute to water monitoring methodology. Next is criteria for selection. While selecting a size, location or a site, these should be in mind. This is actually based on the CPCB guidelines. Discharge gauging points of rivers. Now our department is monitoring the rivers all over Kerala. So all these discharge gauging points, we also check the quality there on bi-monthly basis. So that data is available with us now. Then drinking water intake points. Of course, if there is a drinking water intake point maintained by KWA, that should be monitored properly. Otherwise, if there is any contamination, that will affect the people, the life of the people. Then bathing guts. If there is a bathing gut, a lot of people are using, that also should be monitored. Then irrigation canal offtake points. This, of course, we can check for the irrigation parameters. Then if there is a significant pollution output, like a sewage or drains or effluents from factories, that outfalls upstream and downstream. That is very important. Not only the downstream, you should check the upstream side also. Then at places of abstraction for industry, if we are giving an industrial supply to any industry establishments, we should monitor the quality of that site also. So these ones should be in mind while selecting the sites for monitoring. And of course, what are our focus is on sampling. So what types of samples are there? Mainly three types are there. One is grab sample or spot sample. Grab sample means one sample taken at a given location and time. That means we straight away go to the field or river switch. We take a sample at a certain time and we analyze it as a grab sample. And second category is composite sample. Mixture of grab samples collected from same sampling site at different times. Sampling site will be same, but we take samples at different times. Like at morning 10:30 we collect a sample. After that 1 hour interval, again 11 we collect sample from the same location. This is known as composite sampling. Now, next one is integrated samples. Samples collected at the same location, but from different points in the same location. Suppose we reach a river stretch or a lake, we collect sample from different locations. This is especially applicable for lakes or reservoirs. In certain cases, if the width of the river is river is very wide, then we need to collect different samples because there is a possibility of contaminating the banks, but at the middle, may not be a chance of pollution. In that case, we need to collect from different places at the same time. That is integrated samples. Standard operating procedure. We are in India, we are following a standard operating procedure. The apex body for water quality monitoring in India is CBCP. Everybody must be knowing that. So the guidelines formulated by CBCP, we are following that guidelines. And as per the guidelines, this document is prepared. And as Dr. Sojanlal said yesterday, we have finalized parameters for this monitoring program. That is with the guidance of the, pollution control people, we have finalized the parameters. And 13 parameters actually finalized now. This will be our monitoring program. These will be the parameters to be collected for this DPR profession. Parameters like temperature, pH, electrical conductivity, dissolved oxygen, biochemical oxygen, chemical oxygen demand, nitrate, ammoniacal nitrogen, chloride, phosphate, total coliform, fecal coliform, and streptococcal. These 13 parameters will be monitored. Next is water sampling flowchart. A standard water sampling flowchart looks like this. That first thing is planning. We should plan before sampling. Yesterday or 2 days before itself, where we are going and how we reach there, the transport availability, the hour and the other facilities, everything should be in place. Otherwise, we cannot reach in time and we cannot do the sampling as we planned. So planning is very, very important. Then sample preparation, to prepare all the containers, everything, ice box, whatever things we need for sampling, that should be prepared in advance. Then sampling inside. After this, we will straight away go to the field and collect samples. Then what are samples collected? Transportation is the next thing. That should be properly transported to our laboratory. And some samples need to be preserved in the sampling site itself. And the remaining we need to take to the laboratory. There we can store the sample. Not only preserve the sample, we have to store some samples also in the laboratory. This is the standard flowchart for sampling. And for this sampling procedure, this is the checklist. These are all the items required for sampling. Those who are involved with sampling, they must be knowing all these things. Anyway, I am sharing this for other people who are not aware of this thing. One is sample transport arrangement. That is very of course, that is needed. Without vehicle, we cannot go to the field and collect samples. And second thing is sample site location map. That is very important. We need a map of the location and containing the area, the whatever water body we are going to monitor. Then weighted bottle or sampler. That is very important. Without a sampler, we cannot take sample. For this purpose, we can use different types of samples. Weighted bottles are there. Then depth samplers are there. Any sampling device has to be with us. Then we need to have a DO sample. This DO sample is actually for a specific sample collection of dissolved oxygen samples. That is very important. Then BOD bottles, BOD bottles, 300 ml capacity glass bottles, we are collecting samples for the analysis of DO as well as BOD. Then DO fixing reagents and glass as well. In the field, actually, we collect samples for DO analysis, but that should be fixed at this site itself. This fixing is actually adding two reagents for arresting the DO at the site. Later on, we can take the sample to our laboratory and analyze. Or even if we are prepared, we can do it in the site itself. If we are prepared with glassware and equipment like titration equipment, then burette glassware like reagent bottles, etc. And if there is a facility for doing it in the field, then you do it in the field itself. Then portable analyzer. Yeah, as I have already mentioned, this portable analyzer is essential for measuring the in-situ parameters. I have already told that pH, then temperature, conductivity, TDS, etc. This can be measured in the site itself. This is the ideal thing because these parameters are time dependent. While the result may vary from site to laboratory. Then ice box with ice. Of course, we need ice box for preparing certain samples like microbiology sample and BOD. So this should be with us while going for sampling. Then sample containers. Without containers, we cannot take collect samples. To a glass container as well as the polythene containers are available. We can use these two containers for collecting samples. Then microbiology for the collection of microbiological sample, we need sterilized bottle. Without sterilized bottle, we cannot collect a microbiological sample because the result will certainly affect if the bottle is not sterilized. Then thermometer, of course, if the bottle analyzer is not working, we can at least measure the temperature. That is very important. We have to measure the temperature in the field itself. Then tissue paper, that is for wiping the sensors of this sensors of this analyzer, then for pipette, etc. Then identification forms, sample identification forms. Once we collected the samples, that should be identified, or for the identification, that should be properly, tagged or labeled with the information about that particular station. Then labels for selection, okay, of course, this is for this purpose only. Then field notebook. In field notebook, we can enter or record whatever information we are collecting from the field. That is very important. Once we leave the site, we will not get the ambience or whatever atmospheric condition that is there, like whether it is sunny or cloudy or it was rainy or that all information may be recorded while in the field itself. This is used for this field notebook is for that purpose. Then pen, pencil, marker, etc. Marker for labeling the bottles and all. Then trays for carrying bottles. That is very important. You cannot take different bottles and bundles and dump in a vehicle and come back. That is not the right way to do things. So you should be prepared with a tray for carrying all bottles intact without any damage to the sample. Well, this is for cleaning the hands of the person who is collecting sample. Then wash bottles with the distilled water. This is of course required for cleaning the pipette and all. Then spirit lamp and spirit lamp and matchbox, then gloves, first aid, okay, almost we know that what these are you doing for open and then measuring tape. Suppose if we need to measure the width of the river, we can use this. Likewise, if we are taking samples from a well, we can measure the depth of that well using this measuring tape. Okay, next. This is the guidelines for sampling, general guidelines for sample collection. Samples, once we reach the station, first observe very keenly about the water body and all the surrounding locations. All. Then samples shall be collected from well-mixed sections of the river. That is from the middle of the river for homogeneous representative sample. This is very important. Suppose this is a river, this is flowing in this direction. This is the right bank and left bank. Wherever possible, try to collect samples from the middle portion itself. Because in, if we do that, we get a representative sample. Suppose if we take it from here, that will not reflect all the behavior of this river. And like, kindly avoid taking samples from these two banks wherever possible. Take the sample from the middle of the portion. So always, if it's better to have a bridge site for sampling. If it is not, if a bridge is not there, then in that case, we need the banks, or if possibly we can wade through this, walk along the river, and we can take sample. Then sample shall be collected approximately 30 centimeters below the water surface using a weighted bottle or depth sampler. Suppose this is the surface of the water, approximately 30 centimeters from surface, collect the samples. Don't try to collect sample from the surface. We have noticed many times that people are taking samples from the surface. That is not advisable because a lot of floating material may be there, and the oil slag, something like that may be there. So what we get is a wrong result. So always, they should be in mind, always take sample from surface approximately 30 centimeters. Then rinse the sample container 3 times with the sampler before it is spilled. That is very important. All people who are working in this domain may be aware of that. We have to rinse the sample bottle 3 times with the sample for collecting the homogeneous sample. This is the sampling method. This is for one of our studies. We did this. This is a bridge site. You can see that using the slope and depth sampler, sample is being collected from the middle of the river. This is almost in the middle portion of the river. So this is all the depth samplers, and we have a DO sampler here. This is for the purpose of collecting DO samples. This we have devised. You can see that 2 pipes there. We can place the DO bottle inside this DO sampler, and while immerse this into the river or water body, through one pipe water will enter into, and through the other pipe air will or oxygen will escape. So we get sample that is not mixed with air. That is very much required for DO analysis. The stopper of the bottle should not be placed in the ground. Instead, keep in hand before being rinsed. This is also a common mistake made by many people. While we are raised the site, unknowingly we will unscrew the cap and put it in the surrounding area, in the ground. That is not a good practice, because there is a possibility of cross contamination. So always keep the gap in your hand and fill the sample with fill the bottle with sample, then screw cap it. Okay, that is the correct practice. The care must be taken to avoid contact of sample with any external objects, including the hands of the person who collects the water sample. This is also very important. Water sample we have collected, that should be in within this nature or the nature of the river itself. So for avoiding cross contamination, always be careful about touching sample with the hand, etc. And next is, if sampling directly from a shallow river without a sampler, point the mouth of the bottle upstream and your hands downstream to avoid contamination. I have already told that bridge sites are ideal. In some cases, shallow rivers, that is not possible. We cannot use a sampler for collecting sample. In that case, we will straight away go to the, walk through the river and hold the sample box. That is the, this portion pointing against the flow. The man should be stand against the flow and collect water. This is the ideal practice. These are the sample containers. Sample containers used for a sampling container prepared by the laboratory. It's tested for 1 day or 2 days before the sampling schedule. We prepare the bottles and give to the sample collection team. 2 types of sample containers can be used, polythene bottles like of different shapes. That is not a concern. Then we can use glass bottles, of course, for sampling. Sample container and volume of sample required. For the general analysis, glass or polythene container can be used. Volume required is 1,000 a ml 1 liter, preservation not required. For COD, ammonium nitrate, glass or polythene bottles, 500 ml required. We have to acidify the sample to reduce the pH less than 2. For DO, we need BOD bottle, 300 ml glass bottles. I have already told. The required volume is 300 ml, then DO fixing reagents, then BOD glass or BD bottles, 1 liter, 4 degrees Celsius, dark, cannot be placed directly under sunlight. We need to keep inside a box to avoid contact with the sunlight. Then coliform, we need sterilized bottles, that is 300 ml, 4 degrees Celsius, dark. In heavy metals, glass or polythene bottle, 500 ml we need to collect. Then acidify with the nitric acid, SO3, to reduce the pH less than 2. Then says glass or Teflon, don't use polythene bottle. Volume is 1 liter, then 4 degrees Celsius. Then another factor to be in mind is that avoid collection of floating materials with the sample. This is possible when we go to collect samples from a river, there will be a lot of floating materials in the surface. It is advisable not to collect the floating materials also along with this sample. Kindly avoid that. Only samples to be collected. Then leave a small air space in the bottle to allow mixing of sample at the time of analysis. That is also very important. Don't top up. Leave a small air space in between, and this is actually for mixing the sample while doing the analysis. Then label the sample container properly, like this. So this is during our sample collected, during our monitoring program, you can see that sample code. You can write down, the location, date, also time. If possible, you can note down the temperature here, then the name of the sampler, sample collector also you can put here. All measurements taken in the field must be recorded in the field notebook before leaving the sampling station. This should be very important, that whatever information we are collecting from the location, that should be recorded or entered in a field notebook. Next is guidelines for sampling special purpose samples. I have already mentioned briefly about these parameters. One is DO. For DO, we need to have BOD bottles for collecting these samples. This is the picture of a BOD bottle. You can see that it's made up of glass with a stopper. That's very important. Without stopper, we cannot collect it. And DO samples should be collected using a DO sampler. Suppose if some laboratories may not have this DO sampler, in that case, we can use some technique like use a weighted bottle or a steel bucket like this. Then dip this thing, this bottle into the river and take full of sample. And after that, immerse the BOD bottle to the bottom of this bucket and collect without air mixing. There should not be any air bubble inside that bottle, and close the bottle using the stopper at the bottom of the, this bucket itself, without taking out. Once if you take out and put the stopper, means there is a possibility of air. So that should be avoided. That will defer the value of DO. Another one is after this collection, we have collected samples, then we need to fix for DO at the site itself. For fixing also, we need to add two reagents like 1 ml of magnesium, 1 ml of the technique of adding these two reagents. I have seen many people taking this stopper out, fully out, and they keep holding it another hand, adding it. No, that is not allowed. You have to slightly tilt the stopper, don't take it out fully, and then slowly inserting this pipette, add the reagent. This is the correct practice. While fixing, don't remove the stopper. That is, it is written over there. Do not remove the stopper fully. Instead, slightly open the stopper and add the reagents by inserting the tip of the pipette into the sample. You can clearly visible it here in these two pictures. Okay. This is the first step. We have added MnSO4, and after that, we added this thing, alkali iodide acid. from there itself, we get some idea about the saturation of DO. If we are getting a ground precipitate like this, that means the DO value may be around more than 5. Suppose if you get white precipitate instead of brown, that is the DO value is less. We know that that is polluted, and accordingly we can plan for our DO sampling also. This is an indicator in the field. After adding these reagents, invert the bottle 2-3 times for the proper mixing. These are some minor points, but that should be done. Otherwise, there is a possibility of mistakes in the analysis. So for the mixing, proper mixing of reagent with the samples, this should be done in the field. After this procedure, after this fixing, we can take this sample to the lab and analyze for titration in our lab. Always do, it is better to do titration method for DO analysis. Nowadays, DO membrane devices are there, but I think that it is not as correct as this titration method. I think that CTCP people can stop this. This is the fixing of DO outside. This is part of our monitoring program. You can see that is slightly opening it and adding it. Okay. Next is a special type of special purpose sampling is for biochemical oxygen demand. You can use the same BOD bottle and collect samples like what we did for DO. But here, one point has to be remembered is that you should not add these reagents. We are not adding, we are not arresting the DO at this site. Instead, we keep this in the ice box at 4 degrees Celsius without coming into contact with the sunlight, and we then take to the lab and we incubate for 3 days or 5 days and 27 degree or 20 degree Celsius, and then we analyze for DO. If dilution is required, extra sample shall be collected. Okay, if we feel that the DO value is less, I have already told that while fixing itself, we get an idea about the concentration of DO in the sample. If there is white precipitate, or we need more dilution. So in that case, we need to collect more samples. You know, or rather than one sample, we can collect 2-3 bottles of samples. That will come around 1000 ml. Then for COD, nitrate, and ammonical nitrogen, collect samples in polythene or glass bottles of 500 ml capacity.
Sir, how long, sir, timings?
Okay, sir, I'll rush through. S5 is sulfuric acid to bring down the pH less than 2. Then phosphate also, this should be collected in glass bottles. This is another important thing, that is microbial sample collection. Here, we need to collect in sterilized bottle itself. We can use, it is always advisable to use glass bottles. If it is not available, we can use clear bottles like this also. These are pre-sterilized bottles that is available in the market. If we sterilize glass bottles, that should be done in lab using autoclave. So that facility should be in our lab. Care must be taken to collect samples without any external contamination. That is very important because maybe in our hand, the collector's hands have this bacteria. So there is a possibility if his hand is coming into contact with the sample, there is a possibility of cross-contamination. So that should be avoided. Then preserve the sample in ice box at 4 degrees Celsius. Start the analysis within 24 hours. Take the sample to the lab and start the analysis within 24 hours itself. This is the instrument we are using regularly using for on-site analysis. This is a sensor. We can actually analyze these 4 parameters at site itself. These are in-situ parameters and should be analyzed in the lab itself. Actually, I have given 4 parameters. We can one additional parameter like salinity also using this device or instrument. Yeah, then color and odor, that also need to be analyzed in the site itself. For the analysis of color, you need to have a tunnel, a culture bottle or a test tube, pour tunnel into that transparent glass tube and judge from these 8 categories, light brown, brown, dark brown, light green, green, dark green, clear, or whatever you feel by looking at this sample, you just note on that. Then for testing the odor, take the sample and half fill in a glass bottle and shake 3 seconds and immediately smell it. And whatever smell you feel, you write down or note down, like odor free. If it is, there is no odor, write down as odor free, then rotten egg, burnt sugar, soapy, fishy, something. aromatic, chlorinous, alcoholic, and pleasant. Okay. This way we can measure the color and odor in the site itself. This is another important thing, that is a field data sheet. Whatever information we observed in the field, that should be recorded here. You can see that different types of samples, what type of container is used, station name, date, name, collector agency, etc., etc. Then how we take the sampler by weighing or from the right bank, left bank, all this information. Then the field determinants like temperature, pH, EC, TDS, DO should be recorded here, then color, odor, etc. And other information, general information like the velocity of the river, whether it is high, low, medium, stagnant, etc., etc. We can record in this field data sheet. After that, okay, the sampling is over, and our next task is carrying all these samples safely without disturbing these samples to our laboratory. For that, we need a tray like this. If a tray like, compartmental tray like this is available with us, that is very easy to handle all these samples, filled in glass bottles. And the transport facility must be there, because as early as possible, we have to reach to the lab. And the collector should carry bottle trays and icebox for easy transportation, that I have already told. Sample preservation and storage. Some samples we can preserve in the lab itself. Turbidity, refrigerator powers, we have to do the analysis for hardness, acidify it, then up to six months, we can store the sample for analysis. In the case of chloride, preservation not required, but should be analyzed within 28 days. For phosphate, refrigerate, 48 hours we get. Solids, refrigerate again, 7 days, we have to analyze within 7 days. Ammonical nitrogen, refrigerate again, acidify it, and within 7 days we can analyze. Like that, we can store the samples in our lab. Okay, so this is the monitoring protocol for surface water by CPCB. They have, I think it is, it was the part of the National Water Quality Monitoring Program, as mentioned yesterday by Dr. Peebles, sir. So, they have categorized core parameters, then general parameters, etc., trace metals, pesticide, etc., and frequency is also clearly mentioned here. And these are some of the analytical methods that will be detailed by Rishesh sir and Peebles sir in the coming presentations. Thank you, sir. Hope that everybody understands that what are things I have conveyed. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much, sir. I'm sure that there will be a lot of questions, and also this will be a reference document for our future reference. And sir, is it possible to share this with our participants? And also we can upload in our website?
Yes. I have to make some more corrections, but I will upload.
Yeah. Thank you. Okay, I think there are a lot of questions from the people. So the answer to that, we will share with you, as well as we will share in the website also. So details will be given. Sir, it was very nice. And I'm sure that you at least need a minimum 2 hours of this, but because we don't want to this online platform for a very long time, that's why, sir. Thank you so much, sir. It was really good. Now I request Gracious, sir, please. Professor Dr. M.G. Gracious, sir, is retired from MA College of Engineering, currently working as a professor at Vishwavidya Engineering College. Over to you, sir, please.
Am I audible?
Yes, sir, very much. Please go ahead. Your screen is also coming up. Yes, sir.
Okay.
You can go to the display mode, sir.
Okay. Thank you, Sohilal and others, with a very detailed presentation of Mr. Johar. I will directly go to some important aspects regarding the bacteriological water quality testing procedure, and mainly I will concentrate on the MBN of indicator organisms. This is a modified version of my presentation, which I have earlier presented to NSS of MA College of Engineering. So this sentence has come by Gandhiji. Okay. Now, microbial water quality, why it is so important? Infectious diseases are transmitted through oral fecal route, and they are caused by pathogenic microorganisms, that is bacteria, virus, protozoa, parasites. And the main carrier is water. That is the problem. These microorganisms get transmitted through oral fecal route, and the carrier is water. That is why we have to be so cautious about the bacterial quality of water. Okay, then I directly would like to go to say something regarding the indicator organism and why that indicator organism. Concentration of pathogens from fecal contamination are small, but different types of pathogens possible are large. Let me elaborate that. See, the number of microorganism pathogens in a water sample may be very less, but the possible types of pathogens are very, very high. And testing the pathogens individually in every water is very difficult, expensive, and very time consuming. We cannot go and test Shigella, Salmonella, like or the virus or any dysentery causing amoeba. It is not possible to identify each microorganism. So we go for an indicator organism. The third point comes, hence we go for testing of indicator organism. That indicates the fecal contamination. That is, once we find out the indicator organism in our water sample, we can assume or we can conclude that that water is contaminated with the fecal matter. And the WHO gives some specification to define a particular organism to be an indicator organism. The major part is that it should be present. Definitely, the indicator organism should be present when the pathogens are present. And the last point, they should be readily detectable by simple methods. So pathogens are on one side, indicator organisms are on the other side. If at all pathogens are there in the sample, there should be the indicator organism and they should be easily detectable. The reason is it is difficult to find out the pathogen, identify the pathogens and enumerate them. So we go for the indicator organism. Next is, I wanted to specify or detail some of the indicator organisms. One is total coliform, can be of soil origin or fecal origin, and they are heterogeneous, means different types, and found in human or animal waste, and in the soil and water influenced by surface water. That is an important point. They are found in the human or animal waste, that is in the warm-blooded animals. They are found in the soil. They are also found in water influenced by surface water and nutrients. Then next is fecal coliforms, a subgroup of coliforms and present in the gut and feces of warm-blooded animals. Hence are the specific indicators of human fecal pollution. These microorganisms will be there in the intestine of warm-blooded animals, including human beings. Now, a special fellow, Escherichia coli, E. coli, is the major species of fecal coliform group, best indicator of fecal pollution, but the test consists of three steps, presumptive, confirmed test, and completed test. Okay, I just want to put it in this way. If we take a big group of total coliforms, fecal coliform is a subgroup in that, and E. coli is still a subgroup. So classification of coliforms, the smaller the subset, the more accurate microorganism of choice. Total coliforms are very vivid. Fecal coliforms are precise. E. coli is a one group, one member in that. Now, examination of microbial quality of water, that is a comparison of testing of all these microorganisms. Total coliform standard procedure is available, but we have to complete presumptive, confirmed, and completed phase to be completed. And it requires trained personnel. I mean, an expert microbiologist is required. It is very good to check the treatment efficiency, that is water treatment efficiency, mainly the disinfection. Or a sample coming out from any water treatment plant can be very well checked with the total coliforms. And it is, WHO says that it is not good for testing surface or groundwater, because there can be coliforms of soil origin. Next is fecal coliforms. Standard and easy procedure is available. That is an A1 medium is used. Now, third one is Escherichia coli. The best indicator, standard procedure available. Requires trained analysts and microbiological lab facilities. Then the Central Pollution Control Board was very specific about the fecal Streptococcus and fecal Enterococcus and streptococcus. Standard procedure available, standard method 2015, 23rd edition. Presumptive and confirmatory test procedure are to be completed. At this moment, I have to be thankful to Dr. Liji who have provided this one, because I was having only 2005 edition and she has provided me with the latest, that is 2015. Then examination of microbial quality, possible techniques. We can test the microbial quality through most probable number, that is MPN or membrane filter technique. Both are useful in case of drinking water source and water source, and both fresh and marine and recreational water. The important point is the membrane filter technique approach are not recommended for highly turbid water. In that one, we are filtering through a specified filter paper, and that filter paper is being kept off or an agar, and the turbidity will interfere with the performance. Then, now let me go to specifically to MPN of fecal coliforms. Fecal contamination of water and the possible enumeration of fecal coliforms by multiple tube fermentation procedure. It is based on statistical approach. Yields a most probable number, MPN index, of the organism in the sample. It is the number of, to understand the MPN little more in detail, it's a statistical approach procedure. It is the number of organisms that more probably than any other number could give the result shown by the lab test. And this is the statement given by Standard Methods 2005. That is, the number which you are getting, the MPN, is the most likely number which is present in that sample based on the results we are getting. It is the most likely, it is a statistical value. Okay, then what is that? The apparatus, pipette 10 ml, 1 ml as number as required, then fermentation tube, at least 25 ml should be occupy in that, and the vials. Vials are also called Durham tubes. I will come to that. Then sufficient number of beakers, sterilizable sample bottle. All glassware should be sterilized for 60 minutes at temperature of 170 degrees centigrade. That has to be used for this test. Of course, Johar Saab has explained how the sampling container should be. And the glassware which have to be used for this process should be sterilized for 60 minutes at temperature 170 degrees centigrade. And here I just want to show pipette. Then this is vial or Durham tube. It has a diameter of 4 mm and a length of 2.5 to 3. And in the medium, see, this is the Durham tube. I think you can see the arrow. This is the yellowish is the medium, and this is the Durham tube inside. And how we introduce the Durham tube and the solution, I will tell you. And this is the one which gives this. This has become turbid, and a gas bubble is trapped in the inverted wire. Inverted wire, Durham tube or inverted wire. See, the vial is inverted. Now, coming to the reagent for that is seven medium. Either we can go for a ready-made medium, which is called A1 medium, or standard method gives the components of this one and its concentration, lactose, tryptophan, isophenyl, then a reagent gradient. Best way is, even the standard method say, for go mixing may create problem. So better to go for ready-made A1 medium. It is in powder form, it is available, and the solution form may be prepared as per direction given by the manufacturer. How much gram in how much water of what temperature is given by the manufacturers. And this is permitted by standard methods to do it like that. Now, collection of sample, I think I need not spend any more time on this one. Just I want to say that as per standard methods, the sample can be kept at below 10 degrees centigrade, and it should be done as far as possible on the same day, or maximum you can keep it for 30 hours. This is what standard method says. Is it okay? Now let me come to the procedure. That is, we have, as per the A1 medium specification, we have prepared the solution, A1 solution. and dispense 10 ml of A1 medium in the fermentation tube having inverted vials. It is also called a Durham tube. And then, see, we have not sterilized it. Close with the metal or heat-resistant plastic caps or cotton bud. Then comes sterilization. Sterilize by autoclaving for 10 minutes or in pressure cooker 15 minutes. This is very important. That is, we have filled the fermentation tube 10 ml of A1 medium, prepared as per the direction of the manufacturers. Then close it with metal or heat-resistant plastic caps and cotton bud. Then sterilize using autoclave for 10 minutes or in pressure cooker. That is, it is sterilized under pressure, under steam. Then all what is impurities get removed, that any other microorganism get removed in that. Then we can store in dark at room temperature for less than 7 days, the sterilized medium. Then for 10 ml sample, see, there can be 10 ml sample or 1 ml sample or 0.1 sample. When we are using 10 ml sample, prepare double strength medium. Okay. Now, to continue with the procedure, arrange fermentation tubes in rows of 5 tubes in each in test tube racker. That is, combinations of 5 tubes in a test tube racker. There we should have 3 combinations, 3 sets of 5 tubes, 15 tubes. Arrange fermentation tubes in rows of 5 tubes each in test tube racker. Then the number of 5 tubes rows and the sample volume to be used depends on the quality and the character of the water. For portable water, we can go for 5 tubes of 20 ml portions, or we can go for 10 tubes of 10 ml portions, or 1 tube of 100 ml portion. This is for portable, that is the water which we have to use for drinking. Now, non-portable water means the sample which we take from river, lake, and all those things. Multiple, and sub-multiples of 10 ml, that is 10, 1.1, etc., depending on the density of organism. See, I would like to repeat it here. In the case of non-portable water, we should have 3 combinations, so 3 dilutions. 5 tubes of 10, 5 tubes of 1 ml, and 0.1 ml 5 tubes. And again, we can go for 1.1 or 0.01. See, that depends on the density of the organism. Before, now we have sterilized the sample, and we have decided which combination we have to go for, depending upon the possible strength of microorganism. So we have the sterilized bottle. Before inoculation of the medium with the sample, shake the sample vigorously about 25 times. The sterilized growth medium is there with the inverted vial in our test rack. And now we are going to inoculate that. Before inoculation, shake the sample vigorously about 25 times. Inoculate each tube on a set of 5 replicate samples only. You have to ask Johar sir has told how to open the cap of that DO bottle. If possible, you should have an inoculating chamber. Otherwise, within a short while, you have to open that cotton plug and you have to introduce the sample, 10 ml or 1 ml or 2 ml. It taken in a sterilized pipette. The time elapsed should be very, very short. Within 2-3 seconds, it should happen. You cannot open it for a long time, maybe maximum 5 seconds. You open it, introduce that, just measure 1 or 0.1 or 10 ml, open the cotton plug, put it. Within 5 seconds, it should be over. Mix test portion in the medium with the gentle agitation. Here, I would like to caution that the test tube should not be shaken up and down. Only the bottom portion has to be done. I think I will just show it. See, you cannot shake the test tube with the cotton and the medium like this. You can do it like this, so that the medium and the sample should not touch the cotton plug kept at the bottom, at the top, sorry. Now, incubate for three hours at 35 degree plus or minus 0.5 degree centigrade in a microbiological incubator. Then, after 3 hours, increase the temperature to 44 plus or minus 0.2 degree centigrade and incubate for an additional incubate for additional 21. That is initially 3 hours at 35 degrees centigrade. After that, 44 degree plus or minus 0.2 for 21 plus or minus 2 hours. Gas production in any A1 broth culture tubes within 24 hours or less indicates coliform of fecal origin. I forgot to tell one thing. That is, earlier I was telling how to get that medium inside that inverted vial. You just, before sterilization, you introduce that vial for the solution. But once you are putting it in the autoclave or in pressure cooker, steaming for 15 minutes, the air bubbles inside the tube will escape out. And once you take it out, the DRAM tubes will be full of liquid, full of liquid. Now, after this incubation, that is after 24 hours, initially 3 hours and lately 21 hours, you can see for positive tubes, gas bubbles trapped in that inverted vial, and the liquid will be already converted to not a transparent, it will become turbid because of the growth of the fecal coliforms. So two things are there, the medium will turn turbid and there will be gas bubbles trapped, which I have shown you earlier, and that is taken to be a positive. Now, obtain MPN from positive broth tubes as per or referring to the given table in standard methods 2005, 2010, 2015, it is there. A statistical approach table is given and how many positive, negative things are there based on that one. So you just remember that we have 5 tubes of 10 ml sample, another 5 tubes of 1 ml sample, and another 5 tubes of 0.1 ml sample. See how many positives are there in the first 5, how many positives are there in the second 5, how many positives are there in the third 5. Now, if we have used 10 tubes of 10 ml, that is potable water, I have told you, this table is reproduced from standard methods. For potable water, if we have 10 tubes of 10 ml, then number of positives are given this number of positives. MPN index per 100 ml less than 1.1 and greater than, we can enumerate up to this level, and 95% confidence. It's a statistical poisonous ratio. The probability is in the poisonous ratio, so a lower limit and upper limit of 95 is given. Okay. Now, if you have 5 tubes each of 3 group, that is 5 tubes of 10 ml, 5 tubes of 1 ml, 5 tubes of 0.1 ml, then how many plus are there from the first 5? If it is 1, see, first 5 only 1 positive, second 5 no positive, third 5 no positive, the MPN is 2. For another example, if the first tube all 5 are positive, second tube 1 ml all are positive, third tube 0.1 ml none is positive, then the MPN is 240. Like that, referring to this table, you can find out the value. Now, see, this I have just to reproduce. This is something which I have taken from the lab manual provided to our students. I have just taken the observation table. Okay. To understand this, maybe some of you which are not exposed to environmental engineering field may be having this doubt. So, original sample. This is the original sample. Now we have 5 tubes to receive 10 ml sample. There are 5 tubes to receive 1 ml sample. There are 5 tubes to receive 0.1 ml sample. Inoculate accordingly. After incubation for 24 hours, that is initially 3 hours, and the remaining 21 hours at 44 degrees centigrade, this shows all are positive. The liquid is turbid. I could not get a proper color for this one. Here, this is turbid, and the inverted vial is having gas in that. Gas in that. Here in this one, mobile on the telephone on the way. And in this group, only 2 are positive. And in this group, none is positive. I think this part is clear. People who are not exposed to environmental engineering may have doubt. That is why I displayed this one. And now, so with this, I am through with the MPN of fecal coliforms. This table gives the procedure to be adopted in the case of total coliforms. The first step is to asymptote MPN process. Now, only the medium is different as compared to the fecal coliforms. Only the medium is concerned. There, A1 medium was used. Here, lauryl tryptose broth. That is, first inoculate this permutation combination with the lauryl tryptose broth. and that is a presumptive test. Positives will give you a presumptive test, and from there we have to complete all these that is confirmed test. But first is presumptive test, second is confirmed test, then third is completed test. And this is where I told we require an expertise in the level of microbiologist. But the first step we can very definitely do, any civil engineering background person should be able to do that, and that is the presumptive test. We can find out the MPN, as I explained earlier, using the multiple tube fermentation technique. Only difference is, instead of A1 medium, here we are using lauryl tryptase broth, a medium for that. And that will give you the presumptive number of MPN of total polyforms. Okay, next is, yesterday Sheila ma'am was very, very specific regarding the testing of streptococcus and enterococcus. This procedure I have taken from 2015. From 2005, it was not there. It was under preparation. 2015, this I have received from Dr. Liji from IIT Madras. And here also, the procedure is same, but the broth is, or the medium is different. Here we have an aside dextrose broth and another bile esculian aside agar. The first one is used to do the presumptive test. The second one is used to do the completed test. So here also we have to do the presumptive test and the completed test. All other procedures, that is transferring from the presumptive test to the completed test. All here, the multiple tube fermentation techniques can be used, and we can enumerate. But for total coliforms and the streptococci, it is as per the standard methods, we have to do the presumptive test, the confirmatory test, and the completed test. Or we may have to enumerate or finish after doing the presumptive test. And the advantage of then another thing is, what is that? Agar medium, that is.
Gracious sir, maybe conclude maybe in 3 to 5 minutes.
I'm through. If we are going for, I have told you that is agar medium, that is plate count. Then the problem and then and I am through. I'm dedicating to the less privileged of my country. Thank you
very much, sir, and it's been a really great pleasure for giving this much details. Now I request Dr. Deepesh, the scientist C from the Central Pollution Control Board, region directed, Bangalore. So he's with us, sir. Over to you, sir. Dr. Deepesh. So please, not audible. Please try again, sir. Not audible, sir.
Is it audible now?
Yeah, perfectly audible, sir. Perfect. Yeah. Yes, Dr. Deepesh, sir, Central Pollution Control Board, Region Director, Bangalore. Sir, welcome, sir.
Yeah. So I think my topic is a small walkthrough through the standard operating procedures which we yesterday we discussed regarding the water quality monitoring. So I think almost most of the things have been covered in the previous presentations. Anyway, I'll be doing a quick rundown through that. It's a very brief rundown, and it would be more if it is more good if it is in an interactive session. So any questions or any doubt, you can stop me and ask the questions. So shall I go to the slides, sir?
Sir, please go through the slides, and we'll take all the questions at the end of your session. So that, okay. As it is in the virtual mode, I prefer that, sir.
Okay.
So quickly, you can go through the slides, and then we'll take more time for questions.
Okay.
Sir, visible? Yes, sir. Go to the display mode, sir.
Yeah. Is it visible? Hello.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Water sampling and preservation techniques. Visible.
Yeah. Actually, this is a small extract from our SOPs. It's very brief, and I think I will be doing it within 15 minutes. So let us start with the stations. So when you talk about water quality monitoring in a river or any water body, we have to fix stations, water quality monitoring stations. And as per the guidelines, we have prepared a guideline in 2017 regarding water quality monitoring. And as per our guideline, there are baseline station, flux station, trend station, and hotspots. So baseline station is something which is very away from human activities, and they are pristine and not polluted by the human activity or anthropogenic activities. So flux stations and impact stations are like those which receive the load, pollution load, or there is a direct discharge of some pollutant is there. Those are termed as flux and impact stations. And trend stations are those which we use for getting the trend over a period of time. So how a particular parameter is doing, or how it is coming up over a year or over a particular period of time, those stations we call it as trend stations. And finally, hotspots is those stations which where some of the parameters, drinking water parameters, exceed the permissible limit for drinking water. And as you know, the polluted stretches, you know, it's a stretch demarcated, which is polluted, or the many hotspots are there. So going to this river water quality monitoring, our sampling stations will be a combination of baseline, trend, flux, and hotspots stations. So when you do a particular river, when you do a water quality monitoring of a river, all these type of stations should be there: baseline stations, hotspots, flux stations, and trend stations. And based on this, there is a monitoring frequency. So when it is when it comes to baseline, it is once in 2 months, or it is 6 samples per year. And when it is a trend station, it is monthly once, or 12 samples per year. And when it comes to flux and hotspots, it is twice a month. So we will be having 24 samples in a year. So these are the parameters which we have to go for these stations. So first baseline station, you can see a number of parameters, like 8 general parameter, 3 nutrients, 2 demand parameters, that is BOD and COD, and major cations and anions, that is 8 numbers. And fluoride and boron in other parameters, and the microbiological parameter TC, FC, and FS also, we can do it. And actually, this particular for baseline station, there are 2 phases: the pre-monsoon, that is we have to do it once in a year, and where you have to do all these 24 parameters. And rest of the year, we can do with these 11 parameters. You can see in the slide, which is listed here. And for other stations, we have to do 25 parameters as given in the previous slide. And it has to be done 12 times for a trend station and 24 times for a flux or hotspot stations. So now, whenever we are going for a water quality monitoring program, we should have a standard operating procedures regarding all these things. So I think being an academic institution, you might have these analytical methods, standard operating procedures you might have developed. But only thing is, you have to make sure that these SOPs are in line with the regulatory regime, or in line with the standard methods, or harmonized universal methods. So same way with the safety, you have to be very stringent with safety and other regulations. And waste management. Actually, this is a recently a very important field. As you know, National Green Tribunal is now going to this waste management in higher educational institutions. So you should not flush out any chemicals or any spent chemical or other reagents into the sink, so that it will come to our own water bodies. So that waste management also, you have to be taken care. and apparatus, equipments, all those things are, I think, already covered in the previous presentations. Reagent standards also is part of analytical SOPs method already you have in the in your institution. But only thing, make sure that they are all in line with the harmonized universal methods or national guidelines. Then sample collection preservation, I will just cover in this thing. Then shipment also, we will see what how we have to do it. Storage conditions already covered, I think. Acceptance criteria, calibration and standardization, data validity and all. I think already many of the institution may have all these things because many of them are NABL accredited or coming under EPA recognition of under the EPA Act and all. So we will see one by one all these things. So now sampling. Sampling is nothing but to collect a representative small volume of anything to find out it should be in small that it can be transported comfortably, and it should be a large enough to do all the analytical purpose. And the most importantly, it should be representative of the material being sampled. So that is the objective of the sampling. Now we'll start with the sampling containers. Usually many of the places I have seen that we will resort to recycled plastic cans and other things. But when we go for all these things, there is a problem here is most of this recycled plastic containers are made from recycled material, maybe 2 to 3 times recycled. So in these cases, what happened is the plastic which contain phthalate esters will be leached into our sample, and our sample representativeness will be lost, or it may interfere with our analyte of interest. And this type of issues will happen if you use a low grade plastic container. So always use a good grade plastic or a hard borosilicate glass for doing all the sampling. So if you see many of the analyte, most of the analyte tends to get adsorbed to the walls of the containers. So by that, it is simply lost from our sample. So when we are doing the analysis, we won't get a representative level of these parameters. So always use a good quality plastic container or a hard borosilicate glass. So this is universal with all these parameters. Based on the parameter, you have to select a container. Anyway, those things I can show it in the end of this presentation. And some containers are, some of the parameters are very sensitive to light. So they may photo dissociate or photo degrade under light, intense light conditions. So in such cases, you have to use an amber colored bottle. So in case of pesticides, pH and other, you have pH, polyaromatic hydrocarbons, we have to use a glass bottle, which is colored one. So we will call it as amber colored glass bottle. So in that cases, you have to collect the samples in those dark colored glass bottles, or you have to cover with a wrap so that the light is not going to penetrate into this samples. So those part you have to take it, you have to take care when you are doing the sampling and selecting the sampling containers. And another thing is when you are using soft glasses, sodium, silica and boron from the glass container will leach into your sample. So these scenarios one has to keep it in mind while selecting a good sample container. So this thing, I think Johar sir has already explained it very nicely, grab, composite and integrated sample. This is, I'm not going to this. And now we'll come to the selection of sampling points. So fundamentally the sample site selection based on our sampling objectives. So what for we are doing the sampling. So that is the first thing which determines the selection of sampling point. And if you are going to do the testing of the water for drinking purpose, then always it shall be around the intake points in the rivers. And if you are going to study the pollution loads, it will be always accommodating all the sources, treatment plants. And if you are going to see the regulatory compliances, then it will be with the point of discharges from industries or point of discharges from other sources. And and the point of use where it is being used. Those things will come into picture. So this is based on the objective. We have to define the sample selection, a sample selection, sampling point selection criteria, and there is no hard and fast rule. You have to do the checks and balances here and there, and we have to, based on our objective, we have to select the stations based on the objective and based on the physical ground reality. So always there should be a reference point or a baseline point or a control point to compare the other points. So that will be usually termed as a reference station, and in our guideline it is called baseline station. And this will be always give a background water quality. That is means it's like a comparison with all other stations. So it will give always give a baseline data. And additional downstream stations can be decided based on the influence of discharge and based on the point of recovery. If you want to see how when some sources is coming into the river and how long it will take to get it attenuated naturally, then you have to see the recovery points in the downstream. So based on the objective, you can decide this type of sampling stations. So all the sampling stations are generally yield some samples, which is representing the whole system. So always take a sample from a well-mixed zone. And when we are collecting samples from river or stream, the results will vary based on the depth, flow, and distance from the shore or bank. So if possible, always use equipments and collect integrated samples from top to bottom in the middle of the lake, or if it is a river, from side to side or at a midpoint. If a bridge is there, you can collect from the bridge at a midpoint. Otherwise, preferably we collect samples at various points at equal distance across the water body. If only one sample is to be collected, then collect from the middle of the water body. And that too from the mid depth, not from the surface or not from the bottom. So as I told, avoid turbulence and weirs and other things. And always collect sample beneath the surface with the mouth of the sampling container directed toward the current. And you have to be very careful when you are doing the oil and grease, because it is oil and grease always flows. So always collect from the surface. So here actually the mouth has to be halfway, means the container mouth should be halfway dipped, and that surface, this shall be skimmed off. So this is how the oil and grease has to be sampled. So groundwater anyway, we are not discussing here. So this is, again, one more thing is that when filling a container, there are some things which we have to be taken care. So depending on the analysis and the parameter performed, fill the containers or leave the space in the containers for aeration. So most of the organic compounds like pesticides, pH, VOCs, and for sulfate, the container has to be filled completely without any air gap. For microbiological and other inorganic analysis, leave space for aeration and for thorough mixing. And this also, especially in the microbiological analysis, we have to give this aeration space for mixing so that the microbes will not get attached to the walls of the containers. So this is a very particular thing which we have to take care of, because all the microbes are having the net negative charge on their surfaces. So they immediately tend to get attached to the walls of the container. So in order to prevent all these things, we have to get fill in such a way that some space is left over in the container so that microbes won't die. So aeration is there, and there is a thorough mixing so that always the microbes will be in the suspension mode. So as a thumb rule, it is at least 1% of the container volume should be left with the space. Means that space should be left in the container. If the bottle is with the preservative, make sure that if you are filling it in the brim, make sure that some sample you should throw out so that the preservative should be go inside the sample container. Otherwise, if you fill in the brim and you use some 2 ml of preservative, the preservative is lost because of overflowing. So these are very small things, but it is a very, very important in doing a perfect sampling and for a getting a representative result of your analyte of interest. So another thing, the other thing is that some of the parameters we can do it in the field, like that we call it as in situ parameters or in situ measurement parameters. So if possible, always measure pH, conductivity, temperature, and other things in the field. So any delay in such analysis will always give erroneous results. So we have to do all these things in the field, like pH, conductivity, alkalinity, residual chlorine immediately after sample collection, if possible in the field itself. Now, another thing is the sample labeling. I think this has been explained very thoroughly by Johar sir in the previous presentations. I think these are all, we can get it from any standard books. No need to elaborate on all these points. Yeah, now there are some particular parameters which has to be very carefully sampled, and that the concentration of these constituents are always like pH, pesticides and other things are very small in the natural water. So you have to collect a large sample so that you will get something from that one. So usually we ask for 1 liter of samples for pesticides, pH and other organic compounds. But in practice, we use around 2 to 3 liters sampling from the field. So these things has to be taken care while doing all these trace metals and organic pollutants, which may present in a very slight concentration in the natural waters. So when it comes to pesticides, as I told, when you are taking pesticide samples in plastic bottles, the phthalate esters, which is which may leach from the plastic bottles, will interfere with our analysis because it will always give a some response in the ECD detector of the GC. So you have to be thorough. You have to select wisely what type of container you want to take while doing this organic components or compounds or pesticides. And one has to clearly prepare the sampling container by washing it with free of all other contaminant. And even we have to rinse with hexane and other solvents to remove all traces of organic compounds. And we have to cover all these sample bottles in aluminium foil or in a graph paper, so that while after sampling, you have to cover it with it so that the light issues or the photo dissociation and other things won't happen. Even though if you are not able to provide a amber colored glass bottle or a hard, I mean, so colored glass bottles, you can simply use a wrap, brown paper or any aluminum foil to prevent light from penetrating into the sample and causing some photo dissociation or photo degradation. So all the other things should be thoroughly cleaned, like sampling buckets and other things. Collect minimum 1 liter of sample for this trace organic compounds or a trace metals. And we have to transport all these things as fast as possible to the place of analysis and at 4 degrees Celsius. Now coming to the trace metals. Usually when we used to go for sampling or monitoring in many parts of India, we normally see that people just take a sample in a plastic container and tell that it is for heavy metals. So heavy metals have a very peculiar this chemistry, because they immediately tend to get adsorbed to the walls of the containers of your sampling cans. And once it gets adsorbed, it is lost from your sample. So in order to make sure that that they are in the sample, we have to preserve this the samples with usually with HNO3. Why HNO3? Why specifically with HNO3? Because that any metal, when it is in the nitrate form, will exist in a highly dissolved state. So when you use HNO3 as a preservative for heavy metals or any other metals, they will exist in metal nitrate, which is a highly dissolved form, and that will not be lost due to adsorption on the walls to the walls of the sampling cans. That is the reason why we are using HNO3. Maybe many people used to do sampling with other acid, but that purpose, the particular purpose why the HNO3 is used you will not be met with you are using other acids to preserve heavy metals. And also, this sample should be at least 1 liter, and there should be 1% space. Airspace shall be given to the sample container for the thorough mixing of the sample. Now pH, this is also pH also similar to pesticides. Anyway, this is not coming in our the particular sampling which we have yesterday. We have planned for this river monitoring and all. Anyway, this also actually we have to do it in amber color bottle, at least 1 liter bottle. A 1 liter sample has to be collected, and there they shall be transported back to lab at 4 degrees Celsius, and it should be properly wrapped so that there won't be any photo dissociation or light induced degradation of these organic compounds. And in these cases, we have to take care of the residual chlorine. If you any residual chlorine is suspected in the sample, you have to treat or put sodium thiosulfate to remove that residual chlorine. Now coming to the flow measurement, actually as in the flux stations or in the trend stations, we have to have a flux of that influence. So usually we will, if it is an organic pollution, we will do that flux measurements, organic flux measurement in the terms of BOD and CODs. And always if the flow measurements are there, then I think a daily load or BOD load and COD load we can calculate. So there are several ways, so ways of collecting flow, doing the flow measurement. Usually we will do with bucket method if it is the time taken to fill a bucket of non-volume. I think no need to elaborate. I think you people all know how to do all these things. So one thing is that we used to do the bucket method. Another thing is the Venoch method. So Venoch method, we use this particular equation here. So this also we can do it in some places if it is engineered to have a Venoch at the discharge point. And we will do the float method also. In case of some drains or sewage lines, we normally use the float method. We will demarcate a particular line and we will measure the profile, the depth profile of the, we will measure the depth profile of the drain, and we will see the how much time the float is taking to cover a particular distance, and from there we will get the discharge rate. Now another important thing is the measurement of temperature. Though measurement of temperature seems to be a very trivial thing in the field, but almost all thermometers are designed to be fully immersed while immersed in the sample while taking the reading. So but in field we never used to do that. We will just tip the dip the bulb of the thermometer and we'll take the reading, but always take the sample in a beaker and dip thoroughly inside where the meniscus is in level with the water level. So that is the way it has to be done. But if you are not doing in that way, you have to do this temperature correction. So it is it's self-explanatory in this slide, and this slide I will be sharing with this with you, so you can see how it is to be that temperature correction and all has to be done in the field. So as I explained, so to take the temperature measurement, take a sample in a beaker and insert the thermometer, and you have to insert in such a way that the mercury meniscus will be in level, or it will be in the level of the water meniscus in the beaker. So now coming to the sample sampling and that the preservation and other holding times. So this is the list of parameters and the containers we have to take. So you can see the which type of containers you have to take for all these particular type of parameters. Now you can take, see, you can see oil and grease, you have to do it in a glass bottle with a wide mouth. So since we are taking from the surface, always make sure that you have a wide mouth bottle for this oil and grease, and you have to do the preservation of sulfuric acid, add a few drops of sulfuric acid so that the pH is 2. This is to make sure that that organic matter in that in terms of oil and grease is not going to be attenuated by the microbes present in the sample. And here we can see that the holding time is 28 days if it is preserved properly with the sulfuric acid. So this is how we select the containers, how we are doing the preservation, and how long we can store that before it is the analyte is analyzed. So this is also self-explanatory. I'm not elaborating on all these things. Now to summarize these things, we have that some of the core parameters like COD, ammonia, PKM, phenol, nitrate and nitrites, and even total phosphorus. All these parameters, and a sample for all these parameters will be preserved with sulfuric acid to bring down the pH less than 2. And it will be transported to the lab at 6 degree and below in an ice box. So in case of hardness, we will again use acid preservation to make sure that pH is below 2. And in case of oil and grease, as I told, we use wide mouth glass bottles, and we'll preserve we used to have hydrochloric acid to make sure that pH is less than 2. Then cyanide is always, actually we have to be very careful with cyanide. In an acidic medium, cyanide will convert to hydrogen cyanide, and it's a highly poisonous gas. So always make sure that when you suspect cyanide in your sample, always preserve the sample in alkaline media. So pH should be more than 12 with NaOH. And in that cases, in wherever you have a total residual fluorine, always use thio to remove this total residual fluorine, because this residual fluorine always interfere with our analysis. In case of COD and all, you know that chloride and chlorine will interfere with COD. So always we used to do the chloride correction before going to that one. So in field also, you can remove this total residual fluorine by adding thiosulfate or using thiosulfate. And in the case of sulfate, actually sulfate is another very rare parameter, but when you are doing sulfate sampling, always collect it without any airspace, and you have to immediately convert that sulfate into zinc sulfate. So we add zinc acetate and make sure that pH is alkaline, so that all the sulfate in the sample will be converted to zinc sulfate and will get precipitated and will not be lost from the sample. So boron and other metals, as I told, always all metals will be intact and will be in the sample if we preserve with HNO3. Now hexavalent chromium also, we have to use a buffer, special buffer to make sure that hexavalent buffers are exist in the hexavalent form only. Otherwise, this hexavalent to trivalent reaction will happen. And if you are analyzing for hexavalent, it may be converted to trivalent because based on the sampling conditions and other matrix. So make sure that you always preserve with this buffer, which is already, you can get the how to prepare this buffer from that APHA book. And mercury also same as metals, we used to preserve with nitric acid. Dissolved oxygen already George sir has explained very nicely in this presentation. No need to again and again describe all those things. And other things are also already I think covered by George sir. So this is what I have to share with all of you. If any questions is there, please feel free to ask. I'll be happy to clarify any points. Sir, I think we can go for an interactive.
Yeah, yeah. Thank you so much, sir. And it's very short notice. Only yesterday you agreed to join. And
Actually, we are in the middle of a NABL reaccreditation. We were busy with all these things. So anyway, I am happy that I could participate in this thing, though it is a short notice.
Yeah, thank you so much, sir. It's less than 24 hours notice for you, but irrespective of that, you made it such a elaborative, as well as I'm sure that this will be very useful for everyone. And to all the participants, a couple of announcements. This video also will be uploaded in the... Now we will request you to post your questions, and over to Prichi, please, for taking the questions. some of the questions she has already, I've seen that she has already answered through the chat media itself. Over to you.
Thanks, sir. One question was, how many samples, at what frequency the sampling should be done in tidal areas where salinity intrusion is there? Deepesh sir, did you hear me? You are mute. Could you please unmute yourself?
Sir, once again unmute, because there was a disturbance. So yeah, the admin has unmuted everyone.
Yeah. So I think the question is how many samples has to be taken when there is a tidal influence or when
salinity intrusion.
Yeah, salinity intrusion. So I think that has to be decided based on the study objective. What is the objective of the monitoring? So based on that only we can tell how many samples are there. If you are going into the salinity intrusion, how you want to make a study on how much salinity intrusion happens in the lean and in the monsoon or whatever it is, it you have to, based on your objective, you have to design. But if it is a drinking water survey or anything, I think we don't have to take a sample in an area where there is a tidal influence or a salinity intrusion. So I think that is up to our study objective. I think I made it
clear. Yeah, clear. Thanks, sir. Then another question was, what is the limit for selecting integrated sample?
What type of limit?
That is not there in the question actually. What circumstances we should decide that it should be an integrated sample?
You can ask
sample?
Them. They can be unmuted.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
Okay. In which scenario we have to go for an
integrated sample than a point sample.
Yeah. So in this case, see, if you are doing the Idukki reservoir, if I am doing the sampling of Idukki reservoir, so you know it's a very big reservoir with a huge depth profile and huge vertical and horizontal profile. So in this case, what is my objective? If I want to see the temperature, any other parameter or any other thing of which should be representative of the whole reservoir, then definitely I have to go the entire horizontal horizontal stratification and vertical stratification. In that stage, we have to cover the whole reservoir, means we have to do that much integrate samples, grab samples we have to take, and finally we have to integrate it. So this again, it is also depending on the study objective. If it is a small pond or anything, a small pond or a small water body, no need for an integrated sampling. So, but in a reservoir, we all know that there is a stratification, thermal stratification will be there. So based on that, I think we can decide on whether an integrated sampling is preferred or not. So based on our objective and the water body which we are going to sample. So I think based on that only, we can make that decision whether to go for integrated sampling or a simple gram sampling.
Do you think it is required for our study here?
No,
in the sample will be required, right?
No. Reverse sampling, I don't think we need an integrated sampling or a composite sampling. I think a gram sampling will be due. Otherwise, it's a very large river. But that type of rivers are not there in Kerala. So I don't think we need an integrated sampling or a composite sampling in Kerala rivers.
Yes, sir. Can I add
something?
Yeah, sure. So in the case of integrated sampling is to assess the vertical as well as horizontal variation in water quality. So I think that better we can do for the salinity studies. For example, if we are expecting salinity intrusion in a particular river, and some people used to take water from the surface only. We evaluate how much or the quantity of or how much the extent it has gone up. Because in that case we need to take from different depths, like profiling is very important. Since it is denser below the surface, from the bottom and from different depths need to be collected. So this can be well executed in the salinity studies, I think. And another case is, as you said, sir, unusual fish die off in reservoirs. In certain reservoirs, it happens. For example, teacher reservoir, we two years back, if I am right, we had to collect the samples. In that case also, we had gone for this integrated sampling, right?
Okay.
Is that okay, sir?
Yeah.
Wherever it is not required here for our
sample. No, wherever the stratification is there, there only we need this type of integrated sampling, because in river and all, I think it's a highly dynamic system. So I think there is no issue of mixing and other things. It will be a well mixed water body. So I don't think we need an integrated or other thing. Except as sir told, if you want to do a sampling in a saline or tidal, there will be some stratification. There you can go for an integrated sampling. I think sir has made that point clear.
Yeah. Thank you.
Sir, one doubt, sir. Can for a 10 kilometer stretch, how many samples, 10 kilometer stretch of a river, how many samples should we take, like every kilometer or half a kilometer?
No, there is no hard and fast rule based on the distance and all. It all depends on the source and what is the effect of that particular source on the river. So it will be like if your interest is a 10 kilometer stretch, we will be taking a baseline station before the 10 kilometer, that is downstream, upstream of the 10 kilometer, that will be your baseline station. Then you have to find out where and all the sources are there. Those will be your flux stations. And to get the influence of that flux stations, you will be in between, just downstream of that flux station, you will make a sampling location, that will be your trend station. So based on this, you can do it, because based on your sampling stretch, you will be knowing where and all the sources are there, where and all you can fix the trend station. So based on that, you can do it. But there is no hard and fast rule that in a 1 kilometer stretch, this many sampling locations should be there. There is no such
hard and fast rule.
It all depends on your study and your ability.
Thank you.
And yes, there was one question in the chat box that was regarding the, how many samples to be collected when a drain joins a river. I think I can probably answer for that. Of course, that drain need to be monitored, and one sample downstream, immediately downstream, and one upstream in the river, because we just want to establish that the pollution water happens in that particular river, maybe due to the effect of this particular rain. For that, we need to collect sample from the upstream also, and maybe we can take one in the 100 meters down. Apart from the immediate downstream, and another 100 or 200 meters down to evaluate the extent, how much extent it has gone up. That question was by Rajalakshmi, ma'am. Is it clear to you, ma'am? I hope that your query has been clear.
Yes, Mr. Jayal. Yes. Jawahar, you wanted to ask a direct question?
Yes, sir. I had a doubt. Say, we are actually collecting the samples for BOD. We are actually collecting samples for DO. I had a doubt with regard to the time frame in which we should actually make the collection. Because we are actually getting a representative sample, right? So, we are actually collecting samples separately for BO and DO, BOD and DO. We are actually making the sampling for other parameters, for heavy metals, etc. So what should be the time frame between the start and end of the sampling process?
Duration of sampling.
Yeah.
Can be collected together.
You know, I have seen in many places. We used to collect, actually, I will explain what we are doing here. We will be collecting a general 1-2 liter sample in a plastic container for all the parameters, including BOD. DO separately, as Jawahar sir has already explained, DO will be separately taking, and we'll be fixing it in the field. Then we will take another set of sample, and that will be divided for chemical oxygen demand and for heavy metals. So that will go into separate containers. So third, the final, we will take for pesticides, BAH, and other things. But usually when you do the sampling and your one of the analyte is microbiology parameter, we will start always with the microbiology parameter. Then we'll go to the general parameter. Then we'll go for the preserved parameters. And finally, all those trace organic compounds and other things at the end. So this will, we will do everything together only, but this is the, term is a sequence. First microbiology, then general parameter, preserved parameter, then trace organic and trace metals. Like that only we are doing it. I think it is clear. That's what
No, usually we for the projects that I actually conduct in my college, we do it like that only.
Yeah.
But during Jawahar sir's presentation, I got a bit of confused. That's why.
Okay.
I just needed the clarification. But...
Okay. I think hope this is clear for you.
Yeah, it's clear. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Okay, Priji, next question.
Any more questions? Any steps about
there is a question in the chat box. Is there simple technology for bacteriological analysis? I think a lot of companies have come up with strip methods like H2O strip or something like that. Using that strip, we get a first-hand information whether it is contaminated with coliform or not. But I don't think that it is that much reliable. The conventional method is the ideal one for that.
I think the question needs a little bit clarity, because if they are asking about a quantitative analysis or qualitative analysis.
Yeah, that is true, sir.
Can I interfere in that?
No, sure.
Yes, sir.
Hello, H2S strip method is under study for more than 25 years. It is still not accepted by.
No, even WHO has ruled it out.
For standard methods, let me say just a little. H2S strip method is measuring the presence of sulfate-reducing bacteria.
And in river, we
cannot depend at all on that, because even if fecal coliforms are not present or coliforms are not present, if vegetations are decaying, but the only thing is, if sulfate reducing bacteria or H2S strip is giving positive, then coliforms and fecal coliforms may be negative. But if coliforms are positive, sulfate reducing bacteria will be definitely positive. So that information is there. I think I have read some papers.
You have made it clear, sir. It is not reliable to do the measurement.
Yeah. So maybe H2S strip can be used for screening of water supply system, not any river.
Screening
of water supply system can be, and the advantage of that is no lab is required. You make the H2S strip and then the users itself can take water sample and they just want to keep it on their pocket. And just the body temperature will say after 24 hours whether it contains sulfate-reducing bacteria. And if it is positive, then we have to subject it to coliforms or fecal coliforms, whatever be the case. So the thing is, some coliforms may be negative, but for cases in coliforms are positive, as sulfate-reducing bacteria will be definitely positive. Okay, thank you.
Then another question is, will the dissolved oxygen will be varying after disturbance? Where for fixing, you have to mix it, right? So Sanju Sridharan has asked like that.
No, mixing. No, the question is a little bit.
The fixing reagents, right, sir. We'll add the fixing reagents for the dissolved oxygen. The question is that if you do the mixing, will the dissolved oxygen amount change?
It is for the fixing. Ma'am, can I ask? Ma'am, Sanju Sridharan. Say, I'm just asking the like this, like when we are collecting sample from a river or from the center of the river, if we are to collect it from the bridge, see, we have to take a bucket and collect it. So while collecting water, there will be change in DO, right?
Yeah.
When we have to...
If you do little turbulence and all, if you are doing it like
unless otherwise without turbulence, the bucket cannot be inserted into water, right?
That's what.
And also surface water, rather than surface water, we have to collect somewhat deeper from the stretch also.
So
before fixation itself, the DO of water been changing, right?
No, yeah, that is because we think that the bucket is the standard sampling.
No. Because I'm saying like this because since we are institution level arrangements here, for this type of project, we don't have a sampler.
Yeah. Actually, we have to go with a depth sampler.
Sampler is not available. So how effectively we can collect the sample? That's my question.
That's what you have to collect in such a way that you make a minimum turbulence or minimum mixing. So in that way,
so shall we collect it from the surface itself?
Yeah, that is the best thing. Is if you are accessible to a boat or anything, go to that and you have to do it from the surface. And actually, the DO bottle has to be taken. The sample has to be taken directly to the DO bottle. That's all.
Yeah. Okay.
Thanks, sir. Any other questions?
Sir, I have a question.
Okay.
Actually, in the list of parameters to be analyzed, I think turbidity may also be added. Jawar sir was mentioning about so many parameters like electrical conductivity, pH, and BOD, DO, etc. Along with that, turbidity may be added. And I have gone through the NRCP guidelines, and I understand that if you collect the samples three times, two can be during the weekdays and one can be during the weekend. So as far as for this project we are concerned, we are planning to do for two times. So one can be during the weekday and the other can be during the weekend. Can you comment, please comment on that, sir?
No, is it on that sample frequency?
If we are collecting for two times, one can be during the weekday and from the same location, the next sampling can be during the weekend.
No, that is actually as per the NRCD guidelines. No?
Yes.
I think in this particular project, we are going with the National Water Quality Monitoring Program guidelines. That is, we have NWMP guidelines for CPCB has made it. There it is once in a month. So I am not sure which way we are going, but yesterday it was decided that way. I'm not sure about that. I think somebody else can comment on this.
Ma'am, you are asking whether if two samples are required,
one can be during the weekday and the other can be during the weekday.
If it is during the weekday, as the time limit also we have specified for the dissolved oxygen and other parameters, the analysis must be done before 30 hours. So
that
you should make sure that that it is done.
Yeah, that is fine.
If you are analyzing the sample, consider if a drain is joining at a point, the upstream and downstream, that you have to take at the same time. You cannot take after 2-3 days.
No. I'm speaking about that. I have collected, I have 20 stations in my river, and one day I have collected from all the stations. That may be during the weekday. So the next time when I go, it can be during the weekend.
One set of samples is already collected.
Yeah.
Okay.
The second time can be during the weekend.
I think your question is on whether we have to collect the sample. Means if you are collecting in weekdays, only weekdays for all the samplings. That's what you are.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, that is actually we also have fixed this one in a National Water Quality Monitoring Program. We always have the first week of a month. We have already earmarked. So every whether it is a weekday or weekday only we used to collect. But we never used to collect it in the weekends. One particular day, Monday means Monday for all sampling throughout the year.
Fine.
That's what we are doing in NWMP monitoring program.
Okay. May I respond to that?
Sure, sir.
See, maybe she's having one doubt because some of the industries may be closed on weekends. So their effluent will be, I know one of the industry. See, on Saturday and Sunday, they are not working. Okay. And I am doing consultancy to them. And the wastewater coming on those days have very less COD and BOD because it is just washing the things. Just drain washing and all the things. See, the normal situation, the COD will be 1 year in the level of 5,000. And on these weekends, it will be something like 3,000. And if it is discharged into a stream, that effect will be there. I don't know whether she is responding to such situations.
No, on a general perspective, I was asking. Because okay. During the weekdays and weekends, the qualitative parameters will be varying.
Yeah, sure. That even domestic effluents also.
Yeah, even for domestic, it will be varying. And even during the time of the day also.
So always it is better to do it in weekend and fix it particular, like first week of month, Monday, first Monday of the week, like that.
Yeah.
We used to follow that method. I don't know how it is in other.
Maybe better to do it one on weekday and one on weekend day.
Okay.
Because that changes.
Yes, we can
get the compare.
Again, it is to that based on the objective of our study. If you want to find out those industries, so we have to do it.
Like, yes.
I think the person can make a very judicious design.
Actually, this is a sampling, monitoring, and it's like an art. You can do it in your way, in such an elaborate way.
See, we should not be like machines. We have to use our common sense and look at the real representation of the river. And we can very well mark it. That is done on such and such a date or weekend or working day. Then if such a variation is there, that gives a lot of information on that.
That information can be easily recorded, I think.
So. Yeah. Yes.
And so definitely one more sample labeling is very important, madam.
It has to be very properly labeled, including whether it is a weekend day or a working day.
Weekend and even the time of the day.
That information will be very helpful during the interpretation of the data.
Yes. And one more doubt I have. Sir was mentioning about measuring the velocity using a float. So Suja ma'am was also commenting about that, because many institutions may not have a current meter for measuring the velocity at the field. We do have one, but we were planning to take the current meter also to measure the discharge at where during when we are going to collect the samples. But during measuring using a float, will there the wind influence the measurement of velocity?
Yeah, definitely wind will influence, and even turbulence, many things will influence.
Yeah.
But you have to select a particular area there
where minimum effects are available.
Yeah.
And sir, actually, I used to collect the samples from an estuary. At some places, I have only one current meter, so I may have to measure samples simultaneously at different depths and different stations. So what I used to apply is a small technique. I have a 1 liter bottle, and I will fill the water, same water from the estuary, because estuary will have so much of salinity difference. Mm-hmm. So the bottle is now filled with the same water having the same density. Mm-hmm. So it will never float, it will never sink.
Okay.
So in that case, the wind influence may be less.
It will be heavy at the same time,
it will never sink.
That is a nice improvisation.
I used to work out in my field studies. Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
And another question came now, at what time we should collect the samples? Time of the day.
Yeah, again, we all know that domestic effluent and all domestic effluent characteristic changes over a time. It have some peak in the morning and again, all know. So based on our study objective only, you have to do it. So always do it in the peak hours if you want to do it to get that flux of that organic load. And any other time you can fix it based on your study objective. I think Johar sir can add to that.
Yes, sir. Maybe on usual practice, morning is the right time for sampling, because we can easily sample the things once in the afternoon and all due to this some other weather conditions. It is not easy to collect samples as planned.
Yes.
So. I think morning is ideal because there is a possibility of discharging the kitchen waste and everything in the morning itself.
And one more point I have to add here is recently we were into this Periyar River monitoring based on a National Green Tribunal direction. So we were doing it that Mangalapura stretch, so near to the Kodungallur area. So when we we were doing this sampling, the timing of sampling was not matching with the tides. So we are supposed to measure the flow of drains to the river, but due to tide, that flow is reversed. So all these things are very much important in planning your sampling plan. So all these things like time of the day, tides, high tide, low tide, everything you have to take in account. And based on your study objective, you can fix a time. So I think all these things will matter here.
So I think now most of the questions are over, I think. Any more final comments? Anybody would like to have comments? Otherwise, I think now it's the time. I think it was a really an inspiring and a very good session. And over a period of time, we have seen that close to 300 participants were very actively involved. And I've been extended little time because so many questions and very active people. And there should not be any question or any doubt while they are leaving. That is why the time has been little extended intentionally. And even when you go and to the real side, if you have any further clarification or questions, please do come back to us. We will share all these, particularly today's presentation, we will share you in the our website. Link is already given, wrd.mbits.ac.in. Also in the IDRB website also, it will be displayed so that you can download it also. So, and I think, sir, over to Pranav Jyotina, sir, for your final remarks, sir. Thank you so much for here being listening to this.
Yeah, yeah. Thank you, Sir Naji. Almost most of the presentation I could see, even though I was in some other engagement, but I could see it was, I think, definitely our participant must be benefited. The queries were also so relevant because it seems that our team has started going to the, entire team has started going to the field from the queries, the questions that has come up, because they are asking very valid questions, which actually come once you do the work on it. I'm very happy that the project is in the right direction. So hope again, we'll immediately after learning these things with the rejuvenated effort, we will get into the work. Thank you so much.
And again, your special thanks to Pranab Jodhna sir, as well as Biju sir also, and also TK Joe sir, for appropriately placing the right candidates, particularly Priji madam. She was leading a lot of things. And over the last 1 week, our all teams members, Biju Balakrishnan sir from Pollution Control Board, and Dr. Swarna Leda, Dr. M.G. Gracious, Dr. Jayaraj Sujanayar, Dr. Mr. Johar, Dr. Sheila Moses, Dr. Deepesh, and Dr. Meer, all these teams are extensively worked over the last 1 week, and that's a result of today which we have seen. And a special thanks to Pollution Control Board also. And now I request Priji Madam for a formal vote of thanks. All to you.
Thanks, sir. Good evening. I'm Priji, working with IDRB Toronto. I'm privileged to do the vote of thanks after this special meeting on water quality on behalf of the Water Resources Department and on behalf of all the participants here. I extend my thanks to our respected secretary, Shri Pranab Jodhna sir, IAS, for finding time from his busy schedule and attending the special meetings about water quality analysis, and for giving the introductory note and concluding remarks. Thank you, sir, for being the constant motivation and support for the implementation of the project. And my sincere gratitude and thankfulness extended to the trainers, Shri Johar T.S., water quality analyst at Field Study Circle Thrissur, Dr. P.G. Gracious, former principal, MA College of Engineering, Kodamangalam, who is an expert and authority in the field of water quality analysis, and Dr. Deepesh Valsal, scientist C with the Central Pollution Control Board, Bangalore. Their respective sessions on sampling protocols, bacteriological analysis of water samples, and standard operating procedures followed by the Central Pollution Control Board were the vital requirements for the way forward in this project. On behalf of Water Resources Department and all the participants of this meeting, I once again extend my sincere appreciation for the great job done today, sir. I extend my special gratitude to Srimati Sheila, Senior Environmental Engineer, and Sri Biju Balakrishnan, Environmental Engineer from the Kerala State Pollution Control Board, who along with the Deepesh sir, provided proper guidance in finalizing the attributes for the water quality analysis and for extending all the necessary support from the Pollution Control Board for the completion of this project. I also extend my thankfulness to the faculty members and students from the associated colleges
and officials from the irrigation department for being here today and for playing the pivotal role in the implementation of this project. And my special thanks goes to Swajan Lal sir and Dr. Sujan Iyer for arranging the environmental specialist meetings prior to this meeting so that everything was prepared beforehand for a proper giving a proper guidance in this session. That's all. Thanks once again for your time and contributions. Have a good day.
Thank you very much once again, and I request that all the participants to join on our Thursday's session between 4 to 6. That's a regular meeting which is happening with the same Zoom link. So you don't have to wait to get the Zoom link. So Zoom link is already there. And I know that the participants were taking a bit of time for the feedback also because you are very actively listening to that. So kindly fill that form for that so that we know that who are all the participants. So thank you very much once again. Thank you. We are closing the session, and the session will be live because just to take the feedback. That's all. Thank you.
Thanks.